Good morning, everybody. Good to see you this morning. Glad to be through the temperatures that we've been blessed with. Let us go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Our Father, our God, again we give you thanks, God, for this another opportunity you've allowed us to come together to worship you in your word. God, this morning we give you praise, we give you honor for all things that you have done for us. And Father, we ask today, God, that the Holy Ghost would come and be our teacher again. Show us, God, what you want us to know. And Father, this word will not return to you, Lord, but it will accomplish what you will for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. We're in Revelation chapter 2. We'll begin with verse 8, we're studying the churches. Now, some of the theologians would say, you know, that each church is a part of the church age, you know. But I kind of disagree with that, because as you read these seven churches, you'll see some of each and every one, and all, when I talk about church, I'm talking about the worldwide church. You'll see some of these in every church, somewhere. You see churches like this. And so, as I said last week, you know, Jesus, there was some of these, five of these churches actually that he had somewhat against. Well, if we can learn what they did wrong, then we won't have to go through it. You know, the last thing that I would want to happen is for Jesus to have somewhat against this church. I want us to be right with him, because that's all that makes any difference. I don't care what they say out there. Ain't none of their business. You know. But have you ever noticed that somebody that really don't understand something, they'll always come against it, complain about it, or whatever? Well, that's what those people are. They don't know what we know. And I don't say that in an arrogant way. God has taught us what we know. You know, and you know, God wants us to know his will. He don't want us to be ignorant. Paul said that. He said, I would not have you ignorant, brother. You know, so this is why I felt like it was necessary. I mean, God had been dealing with me for a year or two about the church. But as Pastor told me, he said, you won't find many people to teach the churches. Pray that. Well, if you're going to be a teacher, you're going to be a preacher, there's going to be some things you're going to have to do that you ain't going to like. As I said last week, if certain people watch this on the internet, I'm not going to be the most important, most liked person in this county. Because, I mean, these churches hit this area hard, very hard. But now, verse 8, this is the church at Smyrna. Now, for those that wasn't here last week, Perry Stone has got a paragraph about each church, the city. So this will help you understand why Jesus is saying what he said about that church. He said, the city of Smyrna was a seaport city, but an increase of silt over time made port entry difficult for ships. It was a wealthy city, popular because of the science, medicine, and amazing architecture. It was also a very political city that housed many Christians who were poor and persecuted. The chief goddess was Cybele, C-Y-B-E-L-E, and her temple was the largest in the city. Saving followers marked a day when they cut themselves, danced into a frenzy. The male priests were castrated, becoming third gender, meaning neither male nor female. Smyrna was noted for oracles, where spirits would speak through the priestess. And in prison, he said this was demonic. The saints were poor in material things, but rich in their faith and love for the Lord. early bishop of Smyrna was Polycarp, who served Christ for 86 years and was a disciple of John. The stadium in Smyrna held 20,000 and for years was a site for executing Christians. So you kind of understand the things that Jesus is going to say about this church. Verse 8 says, and unto the angel of the church of Smyrna write, he saying, the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. So this is the way Jesus is identifying himself. Now, each one of these churches, there was a meaning to the name of the church. The word Smyrna also means myrrh. In verse 9, he said, and I know thy works, and the tribulations and poverty, but thou art rich. I know them. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. That is a hard statement he has made. Now we know, we've talked about this many times in the past, the word blasphemy means to speak evil of. What it means to. But he said, there are those that say they are Jews. Well, let's put it down into our day. There are those that say they are Christians, but are not. But are all the synagogue of Satan. Well, what's the synagogue of Satan? It's been several years ago now, but there was a visiting preacher come here, and God was dealing with me at this time on this. And I asked him, what was the synagogue of Satan? And so we sat right there. He said, well, me and another guy's been studying this. And he told me almost basically word for word what the Holy Ghost had showed me. The synagogue of Satan is a church. The word synagogue also means a Christian church. It don't just mean a Jewish church. It means a Christian church. It's a church that rebels against the Word of God. How many synagogues of Satan have we got in this community? Satan, he is the father of rebellion. He was the first to rebel against God. So that's his nature. And so if he can deceive somebody and get them to rebel after the word of God, then he got them. Well, even John on over in the 22nd chapter, he said, if you take away from this word, you'll lose your part in the book of life. But here's the thing. People in this area take the word of God so lightly. You hear me quote this many times. Psalm 138 verse 2 says that God magnifies his word above his name. God's word to him is more important than his name is. But people don't see it that way. I was told of a deacon said, well, it don't make no difference what they preach. Oh, buddy, it does too. And I've heard people say, well, it don't make no difference where you go to church as long as you go to church. Yes, it does. Dr. Ed King in Knoxville, he preached a sermon on it. Where you go can save your life. I believe 127, I believe I'm correct on this, 107, 127, he sent his word and healed them. There's healing in this book. But people take it so lightly. I remember several years ago, I went to a revival one night, and I don't remember what the boy preached, but I got to talking to him after the service, and I don't know where, I can't remember all that, where I read it to him or where I quoted Zechariah 14 verse 4, which says, his feet shall stand upon the Mount of Olives. And that boy looked me straight in the eye and said, that'll never happen. He don't realize what he did. Not wrong to not understand something, but don't come against it. Because if you want to know it, in due time God will reveal what you need to know about that thing. I know each and every one of we've experienced that at some point in our life. They still parts of this book I don't understand, and I'll admit it. And you don't either. I mean, I'm not saying that in a derogatory, but you don't. But there's one thing about it. When we get in his presence, we'll know it all. You know? So just think about this. You know, I've said this so many times. The saddest thing that can happen to a person is when you come and stand, when you stand before Jesus Christ, you find out that all your life you believed the lie and be damned. You know, the Bible tells us those that believe the lie will be damned. You know, and that's going to happen to a lot of people because there is no excuse for us as human beings to have as many different denominations and all the denomination is that they believe different from somebody else. That's all it means. There's only one book here. There's only one Jesus Christ. You know, and so we've got to go by it. You know, like I said, if I don't understand it, I don't have to contradict it. Just say, God, I don't understand what you're telling me here. You know, show me, and sooner or later you find out. Now, verse 10 said, that fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison. Now, you remember what that we just read, what Perry's comment there. This was an evil place. That you may be tried, and you shall have tribulation 10 days. And I believe that the 10 days is actually what he said. It's going to be a short time. You know, if we live 100 years on this earth, it's a short time compared to eternity. You know. But then he said, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. You know, Jesus said, those that endure to the end, the same is going to be saved. You know. And this is what he's telling you. You be faithful in what you're going through. I don't care how hard it gets, stick in there. Well, you know, since this pandemic, they say probably less than 50% of the people that were coming to church didn't come back. Well, if you're going to let a little virus knock you out, you're not going to be worthy of it, of the glories of heaven, in my opinion. I mean, you know, how many churches, you know, closed their doors through all this, you know? Well, aren't we supposed to have authority over these things? The Bible says so, you know? Yeah, you may be sick a few days, just stay home, come back, and let go again. You know that. But we really don't have to have it. But you can't convince some people of that. They think, you know, I was told by a person the other day, half the people coming in the doctors now, doctors often got COVID. Well, you know, that puts fear in everybody. But that's what it's designed to do. You know, and Doc, I, you know, the Thursday night you were delivered from the spirit of fear. There has there's been a total different countenance on your face. See, people don't realize how deadly this spirit of fear is. Yeah. Yeah. Well, see, that's what it's for. You're now going to help somebody else. Because you know, you've been there, and so you know what it's like. You know what they're going through. You know. But most churches don't teach what is taught here at this church. They don't teach it that you can be delivered. Just be saved, that's all that's necessary. Well, a baby can be born, but it don't stay that way. It's got to grow. You need to go to a church that will help you grow spiritually. You got to grow up. Right. Yeah. See, we are all accountable for what we know. But you know, there are those people who say, well, I don't want to read the Bible because I'll be accountable for it. You're accountable anyway. Well, you do or well, you don't. Yeah. Yeah. But you know, as a minute ago, as I said a minute ago, people say, well, all you got to be saved, and that's all it is to it, and you're going to heaven. Well, what about John in the 8th chapter of John? You know, in verse 31, Jesus is speaking to some Jews that believed on him. You know, but you go on, he's still speaking to the same people. Go on down to verse 44. He said, you are of your father the devil. So there's more to it than just believing. You've got to live it. You know, Paul talks like being Christ-like. He did not come here just to save from sin. He came here to be an example too. How to live the life that God, his Father and our Father God, wants us to live. You're exactly right. The more we learn from this book, the bigger threat we are to his kingdom. one sense, it was good for me that we weren't even here Thursday night. They had the construction going on. But anyway, Jonathan Kahn is on the Sid Roth program. He's got a new book out, and hopefully I've got it ordered. The title of it is Return of the God. And he says that is why America is going through what we're going through now. All these old gods that was in the Old Testament, they're coming to America right now because we have done away with God. See, well, you know, where Jesus used the example of when the man was cleansed and, you know, and the spirits went out into the dry places and came back, he said that's exactly what's happening to America. We have cast God out, and now he's coming back. These old gods are coming back. Verse 11 said, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh, or in other words, he that is victorious, shall not be hurt of the second death. Well, what is the second death? You know, it said in Hebrews 9:27, it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. Well, Revelation 20, verses 14 and 15. It said, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. I've heard people say, well, you know, when you're saved, that's your first death. And then when you die, you know, physically, then that's your second death. No, that's pure ignorance. All right. I don't know if we'll have time to get down to all the Pergamos or not. We'll start it. This church in Pergamos, it was a materialistic church. You know, that's the way a lot of the church world is today. It's materialistic. You know, and the word Pergamos also, it means united or married is what it means in the Greek. It said, unto the angel of the church of Pergamos write these things, saith he which has the sharp sword with two edges. Now, this sharp sword is a very large sword, the way it's described in the Greek. Well, we know that Jesus' sword is the word of his mouth, the word of God. He said, I know thy work, for thou dwellest even where Satan's seat is. Jesus is having a hard time with these churches. You know, one's the synagogue of Satan, the other is the seat. You know, I should read what he said about this church. It said the city of Pergamos was built on a hill overlooking the area below and the capital of Asia Minor. The city was a stronghold for idolatry and noted for its pagan temples, including one dedicated to Caesar, another to Zeus. Athena was worshipped as the patron goddess whom the heathen citizens believed protected the city. Christ called Pergamos the place where Satan dwells, and where Satan's seat is was located because demonic powers controlled the people in this region. Antipas, a believer, was martyred in this city, and it was the home of a heretical group called the Nicolaitans. So that helps us to understand why Jesus is saying what he had to say about this thing. I honestly believe you could call a lot of the area that we live in Satan's seat. Because what's going on is pure demonic. It's not godly. Is it? And thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even those days where Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. Now, what I've read is this man Antipas they roasted him in a brazen bowl. I mean, when you read through the Bible and some of the old history, I mean, people were evil. I mean, they did some awful things to people. They seemed like they didn't care. And that very same spirit is coming back in America. You see things on TV that people are doing to people, it's just unbelievable. The way they treat each other. 14 said, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak, who cast his stumbling block before the children of Israel, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. You know, Balaam, we know the story of Balaam. Basically, Balaam was after money. He wanted to do it for money, but God wouldn't let him. And this is the same thing that happens with a lot of ministers today. They seem like they're just after your money. Yes, you got to have money to run a ministry. But, you know, you don't have to fleece the people to get it. God will provide if you allow. He said, and to commit fornication. You know, this is a big thing today. You know, they seem like there's not many people anymore getting married. They all just live together. You know, well, if I don't like it, I'll just move on. You know, there's no commitment. There's no commitment to God and the church. There's no commitment in marriage. And it all stems from what I said a minute ago. These spirits are coming back that we saw in the Old Testament. People don't understand. Spirits never die. The only time we're going to get rid of these evil spirits is when Jesus cast them into the lake of fire. Other than that, we're going to deal with them till he does that. But, the demoniac, when he cast those spirits into the hogs, they went and drowned. The demonic spirits didn't drown. They come back, they're somewhere else. We may be dealing with some of the same ones. We don't know. Verse 15 said, so hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Now you remember, we talked about that in the church of Ephesus. The doctrines of the Nicolaitans basically says that once you're saved, you're always saved, you can do whatever you want to do. Just what your spirit does is all it makes any difference. See, that's a very popular doctrine today. Verse 16 said, repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcomes, I will give to eat of the hidden manna. I believe the hidden manna also means the word. He will give you the word if you want it. That, as you said a while ago, that's our food. And I will give him a white stone, and the stone a new name written which no man knoweth save he that receive it. Now, this white stone, the winner of a contest, you know, they received a white stone with his name marked on it. And in a court of law, they could get a white stone if they were innocent. But if they were guilty, they received a black stone. You know. And so, therefore, if you received the black stone, then you were condemned. You were sentenced to whatever punishment, you know. This is some things that I think that Jesus is trying to tell us in the modern church world today. We all need the white stone. We need need to be in a right relationship with Him. That's the way you receive it. Yeah. But we've got so many people that, so many false doctrines and this and that and the other with people today. They're out here doing every ungodly thing and think, sure, when I die, I'm going to be with the Lord. They're going to be surprised. You know, I told you many times, you know, there's going to be a lot of people that are expecting to see streets of gold but see flames of hell when they die. But they don't seem to care. They just go on and on and on. I know each and every one of us has told somebody something that they need to do, you know. And lo and behold, as soon as you tell them, they'll turn around and do whatever they were doing. They never change. You see that, don't you? Every day. And that's heartbreaking. You know, even in this position, I mean, I have taught things here. I mean, not my opinion, but what thus saith the Word of God. And I see people that sit under it and go out and do the same thing again that they were doing. If the Word of God did not have no more effect on you, why are you coming to church? Are you coming to see who's wearing what? That, you know, that's where some people, that's the reason why some people seem to be going to church. You know, find out the latest gossip. We are here to magnify Jesus Christ. We're not here on our own. Paul has done told us we're not of our own. We belong to Him now. Well, we'll pick up with the fire tire, God willing, next week.